So, good morning, everyone. My name is Camille Curance, and I would like to first thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present my work today. I recently defended my PhD in the lab of Marie Manceau at the Collège de France, and during it, I studied the morphogenesis of skin pattern in bird. In animal, an incredible diversity of natural patterns are observed, such as a stripe or spot, and in the lab, we study their formation. Pattern formation starts during the embryonic development within an homogeneous tissue. At some point, positional information is generated, providing the first spatial reference to the tissue. Then the cell will respond differentially to this signal and tissue undergoes morphogenesis to form a pattern. A major theory to explain the formation of pattern is the self-organization. In self-organizing system, the positional information is intrinsic to the developing tissue and correspond to small random fluctuation that cause the tissue to spontaneously organize into a pattern. These such stochastic systems are by essence highly variable, and there is therefore hardly reconcilable with the reproducibility seen in a natural population, which is key to fitness. So what can be the mechanism that channel the self-organization to ensure its outcome? To answer it, in the lab we study the feather array. So in bird, feathers do not cover all the part of the body, but they are limited to some area called tract, separated by glabrous area. If we zoom inside this tract, feathers took a specific geometry defined by the size, the spacing, and the fidelity of the motif. Today, I will focus on the pattern fidelity. So, it is set during the embryonic development and reserved from the self-organization of the skin cell into an array of feather precursor or primordia. It has been shown that this process is driven by both chemical cues such as FGF and BMP, and mechanical cues such as the contractility or the stiffness of the skin. If we zoom into this patterning process to observe the cell behavior, we can define steps using really simple tissue markers such as DAPI to visualize the cell nuclei, valoidin that stains the peripheral actin, and beta-catenin protein, which is present only in the membrane of the epidermal cell at the beginning of the process. During primordia emergence, we observe local condensation of the skin cell, which is rapidly followed by the translocation of the beta-catenin into the nucleus of epidermal cell, which mark the beginning of primordia differentiation. We start by describing the natural variation in pattern fidelity among the three major groups of birds at two developmental stages. So when the primordia just appeared and when they are about to differentiate. And we found two major categories of birds. The first one, which is composed of the chicken, the quail, and the zebrafinch, in which feather primordia arose along a line. And the second is composed of the emu, the ostrich, and the penguin, in which feather primordia appeared across a portion of skin. We therefore record spacing variability to quantify pattern fidelity by measuring the distance between two primordia center. So along a line of formation in chicken, quail, and finch, and across portion of competent skin in emu, ostrich, and penguin. And we found that the spacing variability is low and remain low in quail, finch, and penguin, meaning that the spacing fidelity is high, and in the penguin is appear high at the beginning and then become low. In emu and ostrich, it remain high across the whole patterning process. So here we show that there is variation in pattern fidelity in between bird species. Now I will describe the variation in the cellular dynamic that occur prior or during pattern establishment. So first we looked at cell density, and to cut the long story short, we never saw a correlation between cell density and pattern fidelity. We therefore focus on another cell behavior, which is cell shape, and to quantify it, we measure the anisotropy of the average cell shape. Anisotropy is a measure of cell deformation, and it's composed of two elements, so the amplitude of cell elongation and its angle of orientation with respect to the embryo midline. And during this talk, anisotropy will be represented by a red bar. So we saw that in the dermis of the quail, finch, and penguin, high fidelity species, there is a high amplitude of dermal cell anisotropy before primordia emergence. It is maintained when they arise in the interprimordia space before dropping upon differentiation in quail and finch, while it is maintained in the penguin. In penguin, the orientation of the cell anisotropy is along the dorsoventral axis, and in finch and quail, it's oriented along the anteroposterior axis. In chicken, in which pattern fidelity is lower at the beginning, dermal cell anisotropy was first low and then transiently increased in the interprimordia space. In emu and ostrich, two low fidelity species, the dermal cell anisotropy is low during the whole process. Here, we saw that there is a correlation between early dermal cell anisotropy amplitude and pattern fidelity. So in other words, the result of this correlative approach suggests that high cell anisotropy amplitude shapes cell response such as high fidelity pattern self-emerge. So to test this hypothesis, we decide to perturb cell anisotropy prior to pattern emergence. So to do so, we moved on in a skin culture system, and we compared the fidelity of the pattern in vivo to the fidelity of the pattern ex vivo at differentiation stage. In emu and in quail, we do not see a change in pattern fidelity ex in vivo or ex vivo. However, in penguin, we observe a decrease in pattern fidelity, so an increase of spacing variability. We then looked at the dermal cell anisotropy, and we saw that it's similar to the in vivo condition in emu and in quail. However, in penguin, the dorsoventral cell anisotropy present in vivo is not maintained in ex vivo culture. We therefore conclude that the maintenance of the dorsoventral cell anisotropy is necessary for the emergence of a high fidelity pattern in penguin. But what about the other species in which cell anisotropy was present early on? So to do so, we perturb cell anisotropy by using a drug, the latriculine A, which inhibits actin polymerization, which is a major actor of cell shape. And in treated explants of quail, we observe a decrease of the anteroposterior dermal cell anisotropy upon drug treatment. Then we perform the same drug treatment, but on quail, emu, and penguin, and observe the result on pattern fidelity and on dermal cell anisotropy at differentiation stages. In these three species, we observe a lower dermal cell anisotropy upon a drug treatment. In emu, a natural low fidelity pattern, and in ex vivo cultured penguin, we observed no change in pattern fidelity. However, in the quail, a high fidelity pattern, the drug treatment caused an increase in spacing variability, so a lower fidelity pattern. So this result actually shows that early dermal cell anisotropy constrain the answer of the skin to self-organizing process to shape pattern fidelity. But how could it work mechanistically? So to answer this question, we perform a time-lapse image experiment in the Japanese membrane GFP quail. And we actually show that the cells are oriented along the anteroposterior axis at the beginning. Then some cells condensate, marking the birth of the primordia. So here you can see that the cells start to condensate to form the primordia. We then tracked the position of the center of the primordia through time and saw that it remained stable during the whole process in control. We performed the same experiment, but on experiment treated with drug. And we saw that first the cell anisotropy is lower at the beginning and that primordia emerge from small intercalary structure that fuse later. We record the position of the center of primordia, and here we can see that it's the center move more before merging and stabilizing. So this result shows that a decrease of cell anisotropy causes a poor positioning of the primordia, resulting in the formation of a lower fidelity pattern. Finally, we record cell motility, and we saw that the dermal cell anisotropy, that the dermal cell were more motile across the whole patterning space in treated explant, meaning that a reduce of cell anisotropy correlate with freer dermal cell movement and an impaired positioning of the primordia. So here, to conclude, we showed that in species with natural or induced low anisotropy, cell motility is higher and it's result in a poor positioning of the primordia, causing a low fidelity pattern. Conversely, in species with high cell motility, dermal cell motility is lower, and it results in a precise positioning of primordia, and therefore the formation of a high fidelity pattern. So finally, we demonstrate that an early supracellular properties, the cell anisotropy, could modulate cell motility, a key morphogenetic event, and therefore constraining the tissue response to the self-organizing process to shape pattern fidelity. To finish, I just want to thank the lab members, so especially Marie, my boss, and Richard Bayeul, which helped me a lot with movie quantification, as well as the collaborators, so Jérôme Gros and François Graner, and you for your attention.
So, very interesting talk. This is a question from Rebecca Behrens. How does the difference between finch and penguin occur? Do you think there is a molecular system underlying which is conserved, and then lost in finch or re-established in penguin?
So, what we think is mostly in finch, it's happening similarly to what happened in Galliform. So there is a constraint, a small patterning space. So only one row of feather could form at the same time. So this is kind of the ancestral state, because there is a study also on the tinamous that show that's the thing that the tract is established by row by row sequence is something that occurs mostly in all bird, and the fact that several primordia appear at the same time would be something new. And what we think that happening in penguin is that there is more mostly some global system. So maybe the tension, the oriented tension of the tissue is changing. because the embryo have a different shape, and that would cause the dorsoventral anisotropy in order to compensate the loss of the paternal wave.
Okay, thank you. So now we have a question from Catherine Brown, our executive editor at Development. What do you think is happening in the chick where pattern fidelity improves over time? Have you looked at motility in this context?
So no, we didn't look at the motility in this context yet, but it's definitely something that we would like to do. So our guess is that in chicken at the beginning, the motility will be a bit higher than in quail, and that the pattern improve with time, just because through time it will lead to a repositioning of the phaser primordia. Because in the drug experiment that we did in quail, we saw that the fusion of the fusion in some primordia, but in other they are perfectly round and well spaced. So we think that's something that happened in chicken.
So now a question from James Briscoe. What is the physiological explanation for high and low fidelity pattern feathers? Does it affect insulation properties, for example?
We didn't have enough data to conclude that, but it's definitely something that could happening. So for example, we know that high fidelity pattern, it has been suggested that it's involved in the flying ability. So you need to have a precise geometry in order to fly. And for example, in penguin, we can imagine that the fact that which lived under extreme condition, that the fidelity pattern is necessary for insulation or maybe swimming also.
Okay. So now a question from Jack Holcomb. Is this specific to feather patterning, or do you think it applies to other epithelial appendages in other species?
We hope it can be applied to other patterning. And the thing is at the beginning, feather is a condensation, and in development, there is a lot of condensation. So we hope it could be also something for something else.
So now there's a great question from Adrien Halou. Well, says fascinating talk. Are direct mechanical interaction between dermal cells and primordia responsible of pattern fidelity, or is it mediated by extracellular matrix?
Great. So the answer is we don't know, but we think that it could be mediated by the extracellular matrix. And to answer it, we are trying to develop in the lab AFM in order to look across different bird species, the different properties of this extracellular matrix.